So this week we're going to finish up the chapter in Romans 11. And as we've been studying Romans 11, it's the kind of the interlude where Paul takes and he's talking about prophetic Israel and their issues. And Romans 12 begins, as Paul often does in his books. Usually the first half of his book is doctrine, teaching, doctrine, teaching, doctrine, teaching. And then the second half is, okay, what do you do with this information now? And it's about practical application. So hopefully this week we'll get through that, and we'll start with more practical stuff in Romans 12 next week. Last time, it was a few weeks ago, we finished up at Romans 11:24. And like I said, this week we'll go through the end of the chapter. But since it's been a while, let's read where we left off. And last time we talked about the branches and some people being grafted in and some people being cut off. And I told the story of, everybody knows that I come out of the Baptist tradition. That's where I was raised in. And the one thing that the Baptists are very strong on is the doctrine of eternal security, that when you trust Christ's payment for your sins, you're sealed till the day of redemption. Also, one thing they do is they make you Israel, which tends to not work. And I told the story of I ran into a guy that I had gone to that church that I went to, and he hadn't darkened the door of a church for a better part of a decade. And I was telling him about, I was just coming to learn the grace message a little bit, and I'd figured out that I'm not Israel. I'm the church, the body of Christ, and that's something different. And I was telling him about this, and he's like, "Well, you're grafted into Israel. He didn't know anything, but he knew that he was grafted into Israel, and we dealt with that last week. Let's read in Romans 11:17. And remember that when we're seeing these Gentiles here and these in the context, the people being grafted in are Gentiles being grafted in to the prophetic program, to New Testament Israel. And verse 17 says, "And if some of the branches be broken off, and thou, being a wild olive tree," talking about the Gentiles, "were grafted in among them, and with them partakest of the root and fatness of that olive tree, boast not against the branches. But if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root thee. Thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off, that I might be grafted in." Now that's unbelieving Israel being broken off. All right, I got my little broken off branches on the ground here. And the wild Gentile olive branches being grafted in. He's saying, don't look down on these guys. Don't boast on them. He says, "Well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. For," and here's the thing, if you make yourself grafted in, if you're honest when you read, you lose your eternal security. Verse 21, "For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed, lest he also spare not thee. Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God. On them which fell, severity, but toward thee, goodness," because you're grafted in. "But if thou continue in his goodness," goodness towards ye based on your continuance in goodness. That's not the grace message. That's a prophetic message, but that's not us.
That's right.
"On them which fell, severity, but toward thee, goodness. If thou continue in his goodness, otherwise thou also shall be cut off." So you can't make yourself a member of the church, the body of Christ, and a member of this grafted people. The two are mutually exclusive. I didn't give you this verse last time, but turn over to Hebrews. It perfectly cross-refers over here to Hebrews in verse 4, or chapter 4, rather. Talking about tribulation Israel trying to make it into their kingdom. In verse 1, Hebrews 4:1, "Let us therefore fear." Has God given us the spirit of fear? I don't think so. 2 Timothy 1:7, "God hath not given us the spirit of fear," but these people need to fear because they can fall short. They cannot endure to the end. They cannot make it. They can be cut off. "Let us therefore fear, lest a promise being left of us entering into his rest," that's the kingdom, "any of you should seem to come short of it." Verse 11 in Hebrews chapter 4. "Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest." Does our salvation have anything to do with our works of righteousness and our labors? Absolutely not. "Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief." So we see here, when you stop and when you read the verses and you stop making bumper stickers and slogans and following the traditions of men, you see things that are very different here from the church, the body of Christ. All right? And verse 23 and 24 talks about, you know, that the Israel can be grafted back in. They're not cut off forever. Let's not start the worldwide Church of God cult, okay? They can still be grafted in if they decide to believe, all right? And verse 24 explains that hey, they are the natural branches, and if God can make you work, you wild olive tree, he can make the natural branches work again. So, all that to say, if you make yourself the grafted people, you can't apply Romans 5:1 to yourself. You can't say, I'm at peace with God through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can't go to Ephesians 4:30 and say, I'm sealed to the day of redemption. Okay, because the people here in this context need to fear because they can be cut off. And that's not us. So we are not the graft in folks of New Testament Israel. We are the church, which is his body, which was a mystery kept secret from the beginning of the world, from before the foundation of the world, rather. All right. So we can't be both prophecy and mystery. We can't be, you know, it's like it would be God talking out of both sides of your mouth. Behold them which fell. Be fearful. You may not make it. Watch them. Be afraid. And then on the other hand, he takes you to 2 Timothy and says, I'm not giving you the spirit of fear. You can't be saying the same thing to the same person. It has to be two different groups of people. So with that point hammered into the ground, let's move on to verse 25. And understand, when I stand up here and I say things like this, that this grafted people is not you, every respected and well-known and well-moneyed theologian and preacher and teacher will say, I'm full of bunk. I'm full of garbage. I'm an idiot. I don't know what I'm talking about. Where are you coming up with this stuff? To which I would answer, great, but I'm just reading. I'm just reading and believing what I'm reading. I can see here in my Bible, it's in plain English, and I compare Scripture with Scripture, and I choose to be weird. I choose to let God be true and let every man and every commentator and every buddy but him be a liar. So, I'm not hateful towards them. I'm not mad at them. I'm just not going to go with the flow. All right, so let's pick up here in verse 25. And you know, before we do that, turn over to Ephesians 2. I want to do a quick comparison here. Real quick. We talk about the difference between prophetic Israel and the mystery church, which is his body. And sometimes, especially when you see Gentiles being grafted in, New Testament Israel, and you know there's Jew and Gentile together in the church, the body of Christ, it gets confusing. And you start to get lost. Okay, who's this? Who's that? Where are we? But the real easy thing, you know, I gave you the tip last week that if it's one easy way to tell is if it's mystery, it's not prophecy, and vice versa. That's one easy way to sort yourself out. Okay, but let's draw our... Yeah, I got a little bit wild there. All right. Now we talk about, and this is prophecy. Gentiles can be grafted in, Gentiles can be cut off, Israel can be grafted back in. Now with the mystery, yeah, that's really bad. I can't even look at that anymore. There we go. Ephesians, and one of the things here to understand is the root and fatness, the tree that's being grafted in, that was already there. That's not a new thing. That's an old thing. We've got people falling out of it. We've got people going into it. But the root and the tree was already there. The root and the tree is not new. Now look at Ephesians 2, and let's start at 13. He says, but now in Christ Jesus, ye also who... sometimes we're far off, are made nigh, not by your performance, not by continuing in his goodness, by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace, who hath made both one. Now in the context, we're talking about Jew and Gentiles. Having made both one, and hath broken down the middle wall of partition between us. Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances. For to make in himself, in the body of Christ, of twain, of two, one new. The key there is the new man. He's not taking the new people and adding them to the old thing. He's taking the two things and making something new. So this is one
new,
may I say, creature? A new creature in Christ? And the way I always say it to remind myself is, out of two, one new. So that's the easy way to help yourself remember as you're going through this and understanding that Romans is written during the transition period in Acts, and you've got a lot more players on the field than you do, say, in the book of Philippians, and it's easy to get confused. That's the way to sort it out in your mind. New people being added to an old thing, and according to mystery, a whole new thing. Whole new man, whole new creature. Out of two, one new. So, okay, so back to Romans. That was not in my notes. That's free bonus material. All right, so verse 25. For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles become in. And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, there shall come out of Sion the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. Pay attention to the personal pronouns there. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. Now, he says there that he's addressing the ignorant brethren. And I've made that joke enough times, so I won't make it again today. Biggest denomination in America, the ignorant brethren. But, you know, it's when you talk about the mystery of Christ, people are trained that if they hear the word mystery, oh, God's ways are not our ways. It's not for us to know. You know, just God is sovereign. Wouldn't that be nice to answer every hard question in the Bible just by saying, God's sovereign, I don't know. But we're not supposed to be ignorant of these mysteries. Even the mysteries in the prophetic program. There's mysteries in the prophetic program that those guys needed to know. Turn to Luke 8. Luke 8, the Old Testament book of Luke. Christ and his earthly ministry. And people are under the impression also that parables are God's way of dumbing it down for people. That, you know, I'm going to tell you this little story and then you're going to understand, as if God's, you know, condescending. But the real truth is parables were to hide information from unbelievers, okay? But in Luke 8, he says, verse 9, he says, and his disciples asked him, saying, what might this parable be? And he said, unto you, you guys, you disciples, it is given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of God, but to others in parables, seeing they might not see, and hearing they might not understand. So parables are to hide information from unbelieving people, to most people. It's important to understand these mysteries. Now, in our program, turn to Ephesians 3. Ephesians 3, 9, this is a verse we probably all have memorized to one degree or another. Ephesians 3, 9, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. So, in prophetic and obviously in the mystery program, it's good to have some knowledge of the mysteries. We're not supposed to just be the ignorant brethren and say, well, I can't know. You know, who has known the mind of God? I can't know these things. Well, you're supposed to know some things, and you're supposed to know some basic things about these mystery people. And it's funny when you talk to people and they hear you talking about the revelation of the mystery of Christ, they'll look at you and say, these crazy people, they can't go 5 minutes without talking about a mystery. What are they, like Nancy Drew cult church or what, you know? when you go and you try to speak plainly the mystery of Jesus Christ and the basic fundamental truths of it, people look at you as if you're mind-numb robot cult members who want to take their house and their money, you know? And that's obviously unfair, but, you know, which church is the one passing the plates around? Not ours. But that's the criticism that will be leveled against you. But just be strong, speak plainly, long-suffering, patience, love. And that's our job. And let me take a moment here to spiritualize for a second this passage. In Romans 11:25, he says, don't be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye should be wise in your own conceits. And one of the things I found over the years is definitely true, and at least in my observations, is if somebody's ignorant of the mystery of Christ and you try to explain it to them, they will most definitely be very wise and conceited. Okay, they don't know what you're talking about, but they know for sure one thing, and you're wrong. My church is right, you're wrong. You talk to a Catholic, and they're trained to believe that they're the one true universal church, the Catholic Church, and everybody else is a mess, and one day you'll come back to Mother Rome, and everything will be right again. But they're wise in their own conceits. They're conceited. And they may not know two verses, bumper stickers. They may never have studied a day in their life, but they know one thing for sure, you're wrong, and I shouldn't listen to you. That's just the way it is. And they want you, they'll pull out Matthew on you and say, judge not or something. What they're trying to tell you is, shut up. I don't want to hear anymore. All right? And so be ready of that. And obviously, two or three of them will get together and declare us rank heretics. And that's just the kind of thing that happens. We're supposed to be, like I said, long-suffering, patient, and just speak plainly, boldly, but speak plainly. All right? So that was a sidebar. But in its context, Romans 11:25 says, I would not, brethren, that you should be ignorant of this mystery, lest you be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happening to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles become in. So what's this verse talking about in its context? We see that Israel being blind and Gentiles coming in. Now, I have a very expensive Bible software study program at home, and my very expensive program, when I pull up this verse, it points me back to Luke in chapter 21. And it says this is a direct cross-reference to Luke. And let's look at Luke 21 and verse 24. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive into all nations, and Jerusalem shall be trodden down of the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled. Whoa! That's a bad day. That's tribulation, right? That's Gentiles attacking Israel and taking over Jerusalem. And that's an interesting cross-reference, but when I read it, I sit there and here's this expensive Bible software program staring at me and telling me how smart it is, and it's got all these theologians and commentators in it, and I'm scratching my head, and I remember, anybody remember the Left Behind series of books? They sold like 65 million copies. I remember when I was reading those books, they pointed to this too. And they had in the book, the Gentiles coming in and destroying Jerusalem, and they said, well, this is what Romans 11 was talking about in the books. I thought to myself, so who am I? You've got 65 million books sold. You've got all this Bible software program. Meanwhile, I'm sitting here going, that's not right. And I looked at it, and in Romans 11, let's just draw this on the board here. And this is one of the things that insulates you from bumper stickers and being a follower of men. And, well, my commentator says this, so that's true. One of the things that insulates you from is just reading the verses in the context and believing them. But in Romans 11, let's compare it to Luke 21 and Gentiles as the subject. Now, we just read in Romans 11 about the Gentiles getting into the tree and taking part of all the root and fatness. That's a good thing, right? So the Gentiles coming in Romans 11, that's a good thing. Now, in Luke 21, we just read people being falling at the edge of the sword and people dying and Gentiles coming in and trashing Jerusalem. And in Luke 21, that's a bad thing. Okay? So that's one way you know that cross-reference is probably not sound. And when you just read it like that and you understand it, you go, oh, okay, well, that cross-reference doesn't work. Sorry, 65 million book author. Sorry, expensive theologians and commentators. But it's very people always ask you, how do I study my Bible? How do I understand? You just read and believe and think and compare. You don't have to have 12 degrees. You don't have to go to seminary to understand. You just have to read and think. Okay? So it's, you know, that's the sidebar there, but I still haven't answered the question, what's the verse talking about it? You know, my expensive Bible software program says it's a tribulation thing and the Gentiles are a bad thing. The other thing to understand is if you can read about it in Luke 21 and is as it is written, that's a prophecy. Okay? And Paul here is talking about a mystery. Like I said, there's mysteries in the kingdom, but there's something, okay, maybe this shouldn't work here. But if you look, and let me just say this, as I look at Romans 11, 25 in its context, we've been all about Israel since Romans 9. Romans 9, Israel past. Romans 10, Israel present. Romans 11, Israel yet and still in the future. And we see here, as I read it, and I'm not going to be dogmatic about it, you all have to study to show yourself approved, but I see Paul kind of switching back here in scope and looking at the big picture. All right? And so I'm going to say that the fullness of the Gentiles be coming in while Israel's blind. Well, is Israel blind during the dispensation of God's grace? Yes, they still reject their Messiah. Is Israel blind and Gentiles are coming in during the dispensation of God's grace? Is Israel partly blind when in the prophetic program? Absolutely. A lot of Israel is going to follow the Antichrist, not the Christ. They're blind to the Messiah that's already came. So I see the fullness of the Gentiles coming in as Gentiles according to the dispensation of God's grace and Gentiles according to prophecy. That's the way I see it. That's the way I read it. Like I said, you got to study yourself to see how you see that. But understand, too, that blindness in part has happened unto Israel. It's not total blindness. It's not total rejection. You got Peter and the boys, you got the disciples, you got the people that were baptized at Pentecost. It's not all of Israel, and they will be restored. The restoration of Israel is something so important to understand when we read our Bibles, that Israel will have all those promises that God made to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, to all the prophets and the kingdom. That stuff's actually going to happen. This isn't just some Bronze Age mythology. This is real truth. It's history future. And we're reading about it, and it's going to happen for them. All right? So, let's move on here. Romans 11, 26. And in the context, we're seeing, once again, these Gentiles taking part of the tree and all that. And Romans 11, 26 starts with, and so. And so what? And so, talking about these Gentiles coming in, he says, all Israel shall be saved. That proves my point that I made at the beginning of the message today. That the people being grafted in and the people needing to be fearful of the severity of God, that's Israel. That's people being grafted into New Testament Israel. And so all Israel shall be saved. As it is written, there shall come out of Sion the deliverer and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. For this is my covenant unto them when I shall take away their sins. There's a time element here. Now, at this point, in verse 26, this is where I see the shift. I've been saying all through Romans 9, 10, 11, he's not talking to us. He's not talking to us. He's not talking to us. This is where I see the shift. He's talking to us about them. He's talking to us about Israel. So this is my covenant unto them. Meaning I'm talking to you about you. That's the way I see it. He says, the covenant is unto them. We're not part of a covenant. Okay? We're outside of a covenant. We're part of a mystery. The covenants were prophecy. So it's not us. And they get their salvation. They get their sins taken away. Here's another thing to understand, too, especially when you're reading Acts, when you're reading 1st and 2nd Peter, when you're reading 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John, that prophetic Israel gets their salvation when their Savior appears. All right? It's not like us where I put my faith in what Christ did for me, bam, I got my salvation. They have to endure to the end. They have to make it through that tribulation, or at least make it to their untimely death, believing and holding on. They get their salvation. Turn to Acts 3. We'll look at this here. I think it's important here to take a few minutes to look at prophetic Israel And he says, as it is written, there shall come out of Zion the deliverer. And at that point, he's going to turn away ungodliness from Jacob. And this is Peter talking here, and verse 19. He says, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come. You see him give a time element. Repent and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when this event happens, when this times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Isn't that what Israel was taught to pray? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What's Christ's name? Emmanuel, God with us. When the Savior shall come, when he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom the heaven must receive until, here's another time element, the times of restitution of all things, which God hath spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. So he's talking about the prophetic second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now some more Peter here. Let's turn to 1 Peter. He talks about it some more. 1 Peter 1:7. Once again, still New Testament Israel in their tribulation context. 1 Peter 1:7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory, when? At the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen ye love, in whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy, with unspeakable and full of glory, receiving what? The end of your faith, even the salvation of your souls. The end of their faith is salvation. The beginning of our faith is salvation. It's two different things. All right? And then he says, here's another thing. You know, this is talking about prophecy and not mystery. Of which salvation the prophets, in verse 10, have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you. Peter's audience. Did anybody in the Bible prophesy come unto me? Or you? You know that 1 Peter is talking here about the prophetic program and not the mystery. All right? And real quick here, here's a place talking about where do I put this Luke 21 cross-reference. Here's the place where you put it. When the deliverer comes out of Sion here, Luke 21 again. They got the cross-reference right in that expensive program, just one verse too early. And that, you know, when I read these passages and I think about from power and might, it's not the lowly carpenter's son. It's not the sheep led to the slaughter. No, now we're going to see him in power as the righteous judge of the earth. In Luke 21, like I said, you know, I know we're going to be in heavenly places, but it might be, you know, peek in on earth here today. It's going to be kind of interesting to see this. Luke 21 and verse 25. And he's talking about here the end of the tribulation period. And there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear, people having heart attacks out of fear. And for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. And then they shall see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then, at that time, look up, lift up your heads, for your redemption draws nigh. Here comes the Redeemer, coming with my redemption, coming with the end of my faith, my salvation, as prophetic Israel. That's what those people are going to see. All the earth is toil. Next, look up. He's coming. It's going to be an... One more real quick and we'll move on. Revelation. Revelation 21. Revelation 21 and verse 11. Well, I think I got the reference wrong. Mm-hmm. That's about the city. I'm looking for the second coming here. Find heaven opened and the white horse. Here we go. Revelation chapter 19. 19 verse 11. And I saw, this is John talking about what he's seeing here at this day of redemption, the second coming. And I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And here's sweet, nice Jesus coming with love. No. God is long-suffering, but not infinity suffering. Okay? There comes judgment day. And he was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And with him he's bringing armies. Then the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. Who do you suppose those people are? Israel. The dry bones coming back, right? And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that it should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. There's your kingdom. There's your thousand-year millennium. There's no disobeying the rules here. The judge of the planet is on the planet. On earth, his will be done. He rules with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. Who wants to be on the receiving end of that? I don't want to be on the receiving end of the wrath of an almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So that's the day that Israel, this tree, this root and fatness who endures to the end, that's the day they get their salvation. It's going to be a pretty big day. And everybody's going to notice. Meanwhile, we in the dispensation of God's grace can have our soul sealed for all eternity, in the quietness of our own heart and mind and soul, and nobody notices. So it's a different thing. We have our present possession of salvation. 2 Timothy 1:9 says, who hath saved us? It's past tense. We have it now. And after he saves us, he calls us with a holy calling. So we're doing work here. We have this salvation. Titus 3, he says, Titus 3:5 says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, not by continuing in his goodness, but according to his mercy he saved us. Past tense. We got it. By the washing of regeneration, by the renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed, past tense, on us abundantly through Christ Jesus our Savior. And that's an interesting thing too, as we look at our job here as ambassadors. All right, and we think, you know, America just... We just had one of our ambassadors killed over in Libya, attacked by Al-Qaeda and eventually murdered and killed along with several other Americans. But when you think about the job of an ambassador, he is the representative of the President of the United States. Okay, he is an American citizen operating in, obviously in Libya, enemy territory. His citizenship is not in question. He is an American. Where he is, nothing's going to change the fact that he is a citizen. It's so when we look at our job as a it's why God has to give us salvation at the beginning of our faith. Because it's our job. It's not like an ambassador over there talking for the president, but we don't know for sure if he's an American or not. We'll have to see if he endures. No. You see how work and how practically the why of why God does things this way. That's our job. We are citizens of heaven. We're sealed. We have our home up there. We're going to go back there. We're representatives of somebody much more powerful than the president, Almighty God, here in Libya, working for him in enemy territory. That's our job here. So that's just an interesting way to look at it there. But let's move on back in Romans here, and we'll finish up the chapter. And Romans 11:27. Where he says, this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. We looked at that. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. Talking about Israel here. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. Now, verse 28, we looked at, and we already studied, and I'm not going to go back on that, looking at what the election is, looked at the advantage that Israel had in times past when, as God's chosen people on earth. We read that in Romans 9:4, and 5 and 6 there about the they were given the adoption and the glory and the covenants and they had the service of God and the fathers and all that. Meanwhile, what did they do with all that? They blew it and they killed their king. Way to go, guys. Don't think you're any better, though. We may very well have done the same thing. So we're not going to go through all that. We know that two things in your Bible are elect. That's the nation Israel and the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's got nothing to do with Calvinism or anything like that. It's about God's purposes, not God's, you get to be saved. You don't. You get to be saved. Not you. It's not about that. Okay? But talking about Israel here, and talking, we're seeing unbelieving Israel being enemies of the gospel for our sakes. And what's funny is most people going to church today are very much like unbelieving Israel. They're trusting in their performance. They're not trusting in their Savior. And they think that they are Israel. Those people need saved. They go to church. I bet they give more money than me. They have nicer cars. They're more polite. They're more loving. Meanwhile, if they reject the cross, they are enemies of the gospel. They may be much nicer than me, which most people are. But meanwhile, salvation is not found in being nice. Salvation is found in trusting the cross and the blood on the cross. All right, it's not about do-gooding and trusting your own performance. And most people do preach performance of salvation for salvation. Even if they don't preach performance, they'll say, "Well, you think you can do X and still go to heaven?" What are they telling you? They don't understand grace. They don't understand reconciliation. They're judging you by some list that they have in their mind of these are the unpardonable sins. All right. Meanwhile, my pattern, my apostle, is a murderer, a homewrecker. He got letters from people saying, "Let me go to this town and trash these people and split up families and kill some and throw the rest in jail." That's my pattern. All right. That's grace. Grace overcomes all that. Grace, there's no unpardonable sin in the dispensation of God's grace. But so a lot of people are enemies of the gospel. And understand that. They are enemies of the gospel that saves our soul. We'll deal with what to do with them in a minute here. But in verse 29, he says, "For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance." Now, obviously, in its context, it's talking about Israel, it's talking about the advantage they had, the calling, the election, the fathers, the this, the that, the other. Meanwhile, what you need to know, some of you have been in fundamentalist traditions, some of you haven't, but this is a preacher paddle verse. If the preacher wants to paddle one of the congregants that needs paddled back in line, this is a verse he's going to go to. What am I talking about? Fundamentalist churches and pastors operate according to the 4 W's. And you think I'm making a joke, but when preacher boys go out for chicken, this is what they talk about. The 4 W's. Win them. Obviously, you want to get the gospel to them, right? You want to get them saved. What do you do after that? You wet them. You can't do anything for God unless you go get dunked, right? I wouldn't give a plug nickel for a man's salvation if he wasn't water baptized. Meanwhile, our baptism is a spiritual one. The Holy Spirit baptizes us into Christ. There's not even, we can do that in the desert. We don't need water anywhere. But that's the first 2 W's. Then you got to work them, right? You got to come into the church work day and the cleanup day. And we know the church really needs a janitor, brother, and you own a janitorial business. Think you have the gift to be a janitor, brother. Amen? Amen? And then when you get tired of all that work, maybe miss a week or two, then you got to whip them. Back them around. This verse here in Romans 11:29 is a whip them verse. You whip them with this.
Well, you have one of the highest gifts in the Bible. You have the gift of giving money, and lots of it. And the money hasn't really been coming in lately, so I want to remind you here at Romans 11:25 that the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. You can't turn back from that. You have the gift. Why, brother, you're gifted toilet cleaner I have ever seen. Why, that bathroom is so sparkly and clean. Gifts and calling of God are without repentance. This is funny to us, but it's true. It really happens to people. People are beat down and oppressed
by their preachers with this verse. Because it's so easy to pound the rod and legalism on people. Rather than saying, you know, hey, brother, we're all in this together. You're good at this. You can get it done fast. You know, we'd really appreciate it as a body and assembly if you could keep doing this. I understand. Can I get you some help? That's too hard. They may say no to that. It's much easier to go, the gifts and calling of God without repentance. I'll sign that tithe check right now. That's easier. That's quicker. That keeps the money rolling in. That keeps the lights on and the mortgage paid. Meanwhile, that has nothing to do with the context, which is a problem. We study verses in their context. We don't go looking for bumper stickers and slogans. Verse by verse, text within its context, rightly dividing the word of truth. Let the chips fall where they may. All right. So after the whip'em verse, let's move on to verse 30. And he says, for as ye in times past have not believed God, yet have now obtained mercy through their unbelief. Gentiles obtaining mercy through unbelieving Israel's unbelief. Even so have these also now not believed, that through your mercy they might obtain mercy. So I asked the question a minute ago, what do we do with the enemies of the gospel? We take them out and shoot them in the name of Jesus, right? Amen? No. We show them mercy. We show that people that fight, people that hate what you have to say and will tell you that you're preaching another gospel, you have mercy on them. Long-suffering. Maybe one day they'll get it. Maybe one day they'll see the clarity of the cross, like you were talking about that Amish guy that just had never heard Christ preach like that, that it's not me doing things, but it's what he did. And he finally saw that. Mercy. Mercy and long-suffering. They may cuss at your face. They may yell at you. They may call you every name in the book. Meanwhile, they're walking away and they're thinking about what you had to say. And you don't know what can happen. Sure. It's the gospel. It's the preaching of the cross that saves. It's not, I did it well. It's not, I said the right words and I did the right things. It's get the information. Trust that cross. Trust him. Stop trusting you. Trust him. That's the power of God unto salvation. All right? So maybe they and their unbelief may one day believe. And it's important also to realize that every person on planet Earth, no matter how rotten, smelly, evil, wicked, jerky, they all have the same access to that salvation. That offer of reconciliation is to all. God will have all men to be saved. So when you see that person, there's no way he'll ever be saved because he's that wicked. He's that evil. He's that unsavory. I'm not even going to bother to him because he won't even listen. No, no. The offer is to all. And you'd be surprised. It's the nice, pretty church ladies that will ignore you and tell you, I don't want to hear what you have to say. Meanwhile, the guy with the tattoos that smells and, you know, smoking his Marlboros, that may be the guy that listens. So don't judge by appearances. All right, the most unsavable person in our mind has just as much access to that salvation as anybody else. So let's finish out the chapter today. And in verse 33, this is kind of like an epilogue to this section, okay? We've had the beginning of the book where he gives the history lesson. In Romans, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4. And then chapter 4 to about chapter 8, we see the basic doctrines of the church, the body of Christ. Then we've come into Romans chapter 9 and we're talking about Israel. So this is like the end of the third act of the play. All right? And he ends with, and you could just hear his heart pouring out in these words here. He says, oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord? Who hath been his counselor? Who does God need any help from? I need to figure this out, Steve. Got this whole heavenly people, earthly people. Can you help me out here? No, God doesn't need anybody's help. Who's going to be his counselor? Who's his lifeline on, what was that one show where he had to answer questions, you could call somebody for a lifeline? It was some kind of game show. God doesn't need a lifeline, okay? He's got this, okay? He's got it under control. But earlier in these chapters, we're talking about who are you talking back to God? Who are you replying against God? Now we see Paul pouring out the depth of the riches of his wisdom and knowledge. Okay, verse 35. Or who hath first given to him, and it shall be recompensed unto him again? God doesn't owe anybody 20 bucks. Okay, who's given to God that God needs to pay you back? Nobody, all right? But he ends with verse 36, which is just a great verse. He says, "For of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen." And Paul says, "Amen." Meanwhile, he's going to carry on. But he says, "Of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever." Do we think like that ever? Do we ever sit back and think about our salvation and our Savior and just how amazing he is, and something like that pours out of our soul, even if we don't say it, but we just feel that for of him and to. It's so easy to take your focus off of Christ being the head and to think about me and to think about this and to think about that, but to actually stop and sit back and say, of him and to him are through him are all things, all of me. We never think like that. We should. We really should. We've been given amazing grace. We've been given an amazing eternal inheritance. And we should be overflowing with that kind of just gratitude. Isn't that God's will for us, to be thankful in all things and just... But in closing here, you know, what strikes me when I read this, and I understand we live on a planet where one thing's for sure, nobody believes the Bible anymore. And the people who call themselves Christians, nobody believes in a Bible. They all believe in some non-existent originals, right? Nobody can actually come to a book and say, this is God's word to me. Nobody can do that. There's problems, there's corrections, there's this, there's that. Nobody does that. And I think about the person who will sing a praise song like that, for of him and to him and through him are all things. Who's known the counselor? And then the praise and worship stops, and then they stop and they start attacking the very word of this God that they just praised.
Right.
It doesn't make any sense. Why do people do that? Why would they praise God and then diminish his word? It's like, you know, the word is him. His name is the word of God. The word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus Christ, this is his book. So I'm going to praise you, but attack this. And nobody believes the historicity of the Bible. Nobody believes young earth. Nobody believes in Jonah actually being swallowed by a whale. Nobody believes that. That's just a story. Nobody believes the historicity of the book. Nobody believes the... But yet, they stand there and they raise their hands and they praise the God who commands them to study the book. Why? It's got to be, it makes so little sense. Did you raise your hand?
Yeah. Okay. That's because it's emotions.
You think so?
They're trying to feel better and they're letting their emotions run them. They're not actually praising God.
That's good.
They're not actually lifting up their hands.
That could very well be. Yeah, because a lot of, you know, a friend of mine once said church today is basically loud music and emotionalism instead of, you know, true praise and worship to God. But that's why, you know, when I see that God has elevated his word above his name, how many of us get irritated when somebody takes God's name in vain, but yet we stand there and clap at the big smiling theologian who takes his word in vain and denigrates his word? We need to get our priorities straight. We need to have a book we believe and operate in the doctrines that are taught from that, rightly divided. Finally, let me say finally again. Amen, and I'll carry on for 5 more minutes. When I look at the grace movement, one of the things I see is that there's different camps. You know, I am of Paul, I am of Apollos, I am of Cephas. You know, which camp? I had a guy ask me recently, which camp are you in? Mm-hmm. I don't have a camp. My head is the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay? What's that?
In the Bible's camp.
In the Bible's camp, yeah. But that's what our focus needs to be. We don't look to a man. There is no mediator between God and men but the Lord Jesus Christ for us. We don't have a priesthood. We don't have a denominational headquarters. We have to operate under our head, the Lord Jesus Christ, which, by the way, that's a lot more scary than operating under the God of the universe. But that's who we serve. That should be what our camp is. It's not we are of this group, we are of that group. No. We are of the book, we have our Lord and Savior, and his gospel of grace. That's who we're about. So, for of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen. And that's something that we need to all work on. It's not about us, it's about him. It's not about our life and times here on planet Earth, no matter how pressing and real they are to us. It's about eternal things in heavenly places. All right, so let's close in prayer. Father, I'm grateful for another day here and talking about your word and just reading these verses and the joy that it brings to my heart to be able to come to this and believe it and to know it and to know things and have the hope for the future and for eternity, to know that this planet that I see that's so evil and wicked and wretched and all the pain that's going to be taken care of, and that you're going to judge on the earth with the prophetic people, and we're going to rule and reign with you in heavenly places, and we're going to be able to, for the first time, without the weight of our sin-cursed bodies and the weight of being in the devil's playground, be able to praise you in heavenly places without fear and without sin, and say, of you and by you and through you are all things. We just look forward to that day, and we're grateful for our job here as ambassadors here on this planet while we're getting still here. In your name I pray, amen.